Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Shakespeare in the Grove 2015. So enjoy A Midsummer Night's Dream.
Caught me by surprise, I must say. Then I found it yesterday. Don't you know that I heard it through the grapevine? Not much longer would you be mine. Oh, I heard it through the grapevine. Oh, and I'm just about to lose my mind. Honey, honey, yeah.
Not much longer would you be mine, baby. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I know a man ain't supposed to cry, but these tears I can't hold inside. Since I met you, what am I left to see? 'Cause you mean that much to me.
Desires like to a step or a dowager, long withering out a young man's revenue.
4 days will quickly steep themselves in night. 4 nights will quickly dream away the time. And then the moon, like a silver bone, who bent in heaven, shall behold the night of our solemnities.
Hippolyta, I wooed thee with my sword, and won thy love doing thee injury. But I will wed thee in another key. With pomp, with triumph, and with reveling.
Happy be Theseus, our renowned duke.
Thanks, good Aegeus. What's the news with thee?
Full of vexation come I, with complaint against my child, my daughter Hermia. Stand forth, Demetrius. My noble lord, this man hath my consent to marry her. Stand forth, Lysander. Our gracious duke, this man hath bewitched the bosom of my child. Thou, Lysander, thou hast given her rhymes and interchanged love tokens with my child. With cunning thou hast filched my daughter's heart, turned her obedience, which is due to me, into stubborn harshness. And be it so, my lord, that she will not hear before your grace consent to marry with Demetrius, so I beg the ancient privilege of Athens. As she is mine, so may I dispose of her, either to this gentleman or to her death, according to our laws immediately provided in that case.
What say you, Hermia? Be advised, fair maid. To you, your father should be as a god. Demetrius is a worthy gentleman.
So is Lysander.
In himself he is, but in this kind, wanting your father's voice, the other must be held the worthier.
I would my father looked but with my eyes.
Rather, your eyes must with his judgment look.
I do entreat your grace to pardon me. I know not by what power I am made bold, but I beseech your grace that I may know the worst that may befall me in this case if I refuse to wed Demetrius.
Either to die the death or to abjure forever the society of men. Therefore, fair Hermia, question your desires, know of your youth, examine well your blood, whether, if you yield not to your father's choice, you can endure the livery of a nun, chanting faint hymns to the cold, fruitless moon.
So will I grow, so live, so die, my lord, ere I will yield my virgin patent up unto his lordship, whose unwished yoke my soul consents not to give sovereignty.
Take time to pause, and by the next new moon, the sealing day betwixt my love and me for everlasting bond of fellowship. Upon that day, either prepare to die for disobedience to your father's will, or else to wed Demetrius, as he would, or on Diana's altar to protest for aye, austerity and single life.
Relent, sweet Hermia, and Lysander, yield thy crazy title to my certain right.
You have her father's love, Demetrius. Let me have Hermia's. Do you marry him?
Scornful Lysander, true, he hath my love. And all that is mine my love shall render him, and she is mine. And all my rights to her I do estate under Demetrius.
I am, my lord, as well derived as he, as well possessed. My love is more than his. My fortune's every way as fairly ranked, if not with vantage, as Demetrius. And, which is more than all these boasts can be, I am beloved of beauteous Hermia. Why should not I then prosecute my right? Demetrius, I'll avouch it to his head, made love to Nadar's daughter Helena, and won her soul. And she, sweet lady, dotes, devoutly dotes, dotes in idolatry upon this spotted and inconstant man.
I must confess that I have heard so much, and with Demetrius thought to have spoken thereof, but being overfull of self-affairs, my mind did lose it.
What?
But come, Demetrius, and Aegeus, come, go in with me. I have some private schooling for you both. For you, fair Hermia, look, you arm yourself to fit your fancies to your father's will.
No,
else the law of Athens yield you up, which by no means we may extenuate, to death or to a vow of single life. Come, my Hippolyta. What cheer, my love? Demetrius and Aegeus, go along.
With duty and desire, we follow you.
How now, my love? Why is your cheek so pale? How chance the roses there do fade so fast?
Belike, for want of rain, which I could well beteem them from the tempest of my eye.
Ay me, for aught that I could ever read, could ever hear by tale or history, the course of true love never did run smooth. But hear me, Hermia. I have a widow aunt, a dowager of great revenue, and she hath no child. From Athens is her house remote 7 leagues. And she respects me as her only son. There, gentle Hermia, may I marry thee. And to that place the sharp Athenian law cannot pursue us. If thou lovest me then, steal forth thy father's house tomorrow night, and in the wood, a league without the town, where I did meet thee once with Helena, to do observance to a morn of May, there will I stay for thee.
Oh, my good Lysander! I swear to thee by Cupid's strongest bow, by his best arrow with the golden head, in that same place thou hast appointed me. Tomorrow truly will I meet with thee.
Oh, keep promise, love. Oh, look, here comes Helena.
Godspeed, fair Helena. Away.
Call you me fair? That fair again unsay. Demetrius loves your fair.
Helena.
Oh, happy fair. Your eyes are lodestars, your tongue sweet air, more tunable than lark to shepherd's ear when wheat is green, when hawthorn buds appear. Sickness, it's catching. Oh, were favor so. Yours would I catch, fair Hermia, ere I go. My ear should catch your voice, my eye your eye. My tongue should catch your tongue, sweet melody. Were the world mine, Demetrius being baited, the rest I'd give to be to you translated. Oh, teach me how you look, and with what art you sway the motion of Demetrius' heart.
I frown upon him, yet he loves me still.
Oh, that your frowns would teach my smiles such skill.
I give him curses, yet he gives me love.
Oh, that my prayers could such affection move.
The more I hate, the more he follows me.
The more I love, the more he hateth me.
His folly, Helena, is no fault of mine.
None but your beauty. Would that fault were mine.
Take comfort. He no more shall see my face. Lysander and myself shall fly this place.
Helen, to you our minds we will unfold. Tomorrow night through Athens' gates have we devised to steal.
And in the wood where often you and I upon fate primrose beds were wont to lie, emptying our bosoms of their counsel sweet, there my Lysander and myself shall meet, and thence from Athens turn away our eyes to seek new friends and stranger companies.
Farewell, sweet playfellow. Pray thou for us.
And good luck grant thee thy Demetrius. Keep word, Lysander. We must starve our sight from lover's food till morrow deep midnight.
I will, my Hermia. Oh.
Helena, adieu. As you on him, Demetrius dote on you.
How happy some or other some can be. Through Athens, I am thought as fair as she, but what of that? Demetrius thinks not so.
What of that?
He will not know what all but he do know. And as he errs, doting on Hermia's eyes, so I, admiring of his qualities. For ere Demetrius looked on Hermia's eyne, he hailed down oaths that he was only mine. But when this hailsome heat from Hermia felt, so he dissolved, and showers of oaths did melt. I will go tell him of fair Hermia's flight. Then to the wood will he tomorrow night pursue her. And for this intelligence, if I have thanks, it is a dear expense. But herein mean I to enrich my pain, to have his sight thither and back again.
Call them, man by man, according to the script.
Here is a scroll with everyone's name, which is thought fit through all Athens to play in our interlude before the Duke and the Duchess on his wedding day at night.
The first, good Peter Quince. Say what the play treats on, then read the names of the actors, and so grow to a point.
Very. Our play is the most lamentable comedy and most cruel death. Pyramus and Thisbe!
Very good piece of work, I assure you, and a merry. Now, good Peter Quince, call forth your actors by the scroll. Actors, spread yourselves.
Oh, my God. Answer as I call you, Nigbottom the Weaver.
Ready, name what part I am for, and so proceed.
Nigbottom, you are set down for Pyramus.
What is Pyramus? A lover or a tyrant?
A lover who kills himself most gallantly.
gallantly for love.
Which is the Titanic.
That shall ask some tears in the true performing of it, if I do it. Let the audience look to their eyes. I will move storms. I will condole in some measure. To the rest.
Francis flew to the
yet, my chief humor is for a tyrant. I could play Hercules rarely. The raging rocks and shivering shocks shall break the locks of prison gates, and Phoebus' car, which shines on far, shall make and mar the foolish fates.
Sorry.
This was lofty to the rest.
Francis,
yet
Luke.
My Hercules' vein, a tyrant's vein, a lover's more condoling.
Francis Flute, the bellows mender!
Here, Peter Quince!
Flute, you must take Thisbe on you!
And what is, Thisbe? A wandering knight?
Yeah! It is the lady that Pyramus must love!
Nay! Faith, let me not play your woman!
I have a beard coming.
That's all one. You shall play it to the mass, and you may speak as small as you will.
And I might hide my face. Let me play Thisbe too. I will speak in a monstrous little voice. Thisbe, Thisbe.
Pyramus, thy lady dear, thy lover dear, thy Thisbe dear.
No. You will play Pyramus, and Flute, you Thisbe.
Well, proceed.
Robin Starveling, the tailor.
Here, Peter Quince!
Robin Starveling, you will play Thisbe's mother. Tom Snout, the tinker.
Here, Peter Quince.
Quince, you will play Pyramus's father. Myself, Thisbe's father. Slug, the joiner. You will play the lion's part. And here, I hope, is a play fitted.
Have you the lion's part written?
What's wrong with
you? Pray you, if it be, give it me, for I am... You're slow of study!
For it is nothing but roaring!
Let me play the lion too. I will roar you. That will do any man's heart good to hear me roar. I will roar. I will roar you that will make the Duke say, let him roar again, let him roar again.
If you should do it too terribly, that would fright the Duchess and the ladies, that they would shriek. And that were enough to hang us all!
Oh, that would hang us!
Every mother's son!
I grant you, friends, that if we were to fright the ladies out of their wits, they would have no more discretion but to hang us! But I will aggravate my voice so that I will roar you as gently as a sucking dove. I will...
Or kitty!
As twere any nightingale!
You can play no part with Pyramus! For Pyramus is such a sweet-faced man, a most lovely, gentleman-like man, therefore we must needs play Pyramus!
Well, I will undertake it.
Masters, here are your parts. And I am to entreat you, request you, and desire you to pawn them by tomorrow night.
What?
And meet me in the palace wood, a mile without the town, by moonlight. There we will rehearse, for if we meet in the city, we shall be dogs with company, and our devices known. I pray you, fail me not.
Well, we shall meet, and there may we rehearse most obscenely and courageously. Take pains, be perfect. Adieu.
At the Duke's oak, we meet. meat!
Yeah. Enough! Hold or cut both strings!
Take heed, the queen come not within his sight, for Oberon is passing fell and rapt, because that she is her attendant, ha! A lovely boy stolen from an Indian king. She never had so sweet a changeling, and jealous Oberon would have the child knight of his train to chase the forest wild. But she perforce withholds the loved boy, crowns him with flowers, and makes him all her joy. And now they never meet, in grove or green, by clear fountain or by spangled starlight sheen. But they do swear that all their ills for fear creep into acorn cups and hide them there. Hey!
I mistake your shape and make inquiry, or else you are the youth and knavish sprite called Robin Goodfellow.
Are you not he that fights the maidens of the villagery? Those that hobgoblin call and sweet puck, you do their work and they shall have good luck. Are you not he?
Thou speakst all right. I am that merrier wonder of the night.
And hear my mistress.
Ill met by moonlight, proud Titania.
What? Jealous Oberon. Fairies, skip hence. I have forsworn his bed and company.
Tarry, rash wanton. Am not I thy lord?
Then I must be thy lady. Why art thou here? Come, from the farthest step of India, but that forsooth the bouncing Amazon, your buskined mistress and your warrior love, to Theseus must be wedded. And you come to give their bed joy and prosperity.
How canst thou for shame, Titania, glance at my credit with Hippolyta, knowing I know thy love to Theseus? Didst thou not lead him through the glimmering night from Perigenia, whom he ravisheth, and make him with fair Eglis break his faith with Ariadne and Antiope?
These are the forgeries of jealousy. And never since the middle summer spring met we on hill, in dale, in forest or mead, to dance our ringlets to the whistling wind, but with thy brawls thou hast disturbed our sport. Therefore, the winds, piping to us in vain, as in revenge, have sucked up from the sea contagious fogs, which, falling in the land, have every pelting river made so proud that they have overborne their continents. The ox hath therefore stretched his yoke in vain, the ploughman lost his sweat, and the green corn hath rotted ere his youth attained a beard. No night is now with hymn or carol blessed. Therefore the moon, the governess of floods, pale in her anger, washes all the air that rheumatic disease is to abound. And through this distemperature, we see the seasons alter. The spring, the summer, childing autumn, angry winter, change their wonted liveries, and the mazed world, by their increase, now knows not which is which. And this same progeny of evils comes from our debate, from our dissension. We are their parent and original.
Do you amend it then? It lies in you. Why should Titania cross her Oberon? I do but beg a little changeling boy to be my henchman.
Set your heart at rest. The fairy land buys not the child of me. His mother was a votress of my order, and in the spiced Indian air full often hath she gossiped by my side. But she, being mortal, of that boy did die.
Such a good boy.
And for her sake do I rear up her boy, and for her sake I will not part with him.
How long within this wood intend you stay?
Perchance, till after Theseus' wedding day. If you will patiently dance in our round, and see our moonlight revels, go with us. If not, shun me, and I will spare your haunts.
Give me that boy, and I will go with thee.
Not for thy fairy kingdom! Fairies away! We shall chide down right if I longer stay!
Well, go thy way! Thou shalt not from this grove till I torment thee for this injury! My gentle Puck, come hither! Fetch me that flower, the herb I showed thee once. Maidens call it love in idleness. The juice of it on sleeping eyelids laid will make or man or woman madly dote upon the next live creature that it sees. Fetch me this herb, and be thou here again ere the Leviathan can swim a league.
I'll put a good old round about the earth in 40 minutes.
Having once juice, I'll watch Titania when she's asleep and drop the liquor of it in her eyes. The next thing she then waking looks upon, she shall pursue it with the soul of love. And ere I take this charm from off her sight, as I can take it with another herb, I'll make her render up her page to me. But who comes here? I am invisible, and I will overhear their conference.
Oh, I love thee not, therefore pursue me not. Where is Lysander and fair Hermia? The one I'll slay, the other slayeth me. Thou told'st me they were stolen unto this wood, and here I am, and wooed within this wood because I cannot find my Hermia. Oh, and get thee gone, and follow me no more.
You draw me, you hard-hearted adamant.
Do I entice you? Do I speak you fair, or rather do I not in plainest terms tell you that I do not, nor I cannot love you?
And even for that do I love you the more. I am your spaniel. And Demetrius, the more you beat me, I will fawn on you. Use me but as your spaniel. Spurn me, strike me, neglect me, lose me. Only give me leave, unworthy as I am, to follow you.
Tempt not too much then. Hatred of my spirit, for I am sick when I look on thee.
And I am sick when I look not on you.
You do impeach your modesty too much to leave the city, commit yourself into the hands of one that loves you not, to trust the opportunity of night and the ill counsel of a desert place with the rich worth of your virginity.
Your virtue is my privilege, for that it is not night when I do see your face. Then how can it be said I am in the night? Nor doth this wood lack worlds of company, for you, in my respect, are all the world. Then how can it be said I'm alone when all the world is here to look on me?
I'll run from thee and hide me in the brakes and leave thee to the mercy of wild beasts.
The wildest hath not such a heart as you.
I'll not stay thy questions. Let me go. Or if thou follow, do not believe, but I shall do thee mischief in the wood.
Aye, in the temple, in the town, in the field, you do me mischief. Fuck! Demetrius. Your wrongs do set a scandal on my sex. We cannot fight for love as men may do. We should be wooed, and we're not made to woo.
No.
I'll follow thee and make a heaven of hell to die upon my hand I love so well.
Fare thee well, nymph. Ere he do leave this grove, thou shalt fly him, and he shall seek thy love. Hast thou the flower there? Welcome, wanderer.
Aye, here it is.
I prithee, give it to me. I know a bank where the wild thyme blows, where the oxlix and the nodding violet grows, quite over-canopied with luscious woodbine, with sweet musk roses and with eglantine. There sleeps Titania, some time of the night, lulled in these flowers with dances and delight. And with the juice of this, I'll streak her eyes and make her full of hateful fantasies. Take thou some of it, and seek about this grove. A sweet Athenian lady is in love with a disdainful youth. Anoint his eyes, but do it when the next thing he espies might be the lady. Okay. Thou shalt know him by the Athenian garments he hath on. Affect it with some care, that he may prove more fond of her than she upon her love.
Okay.
And look thou meet me ere the first cock crow.
Fear not, my lord, your servant shall do so.
La 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 lullaby, la 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 lullaby, la 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 lullaby. Never harm nor spell nor charm, come our lovely lady nigh. So good night with lullaby.
Hence away, now all is well. One aloof, stand, sentinel.
When thou dost awake, do it for thy true love's sake. In thy eye it shall appear. When thou wak'st, it is thy deed. Wake when some vile thing is near.
Wandering in the wood, and to speak troth, I have forgot our way. We'll rest us, Hermia, if you think it good, and tarry for the comfort of the day.
Be it so, Lysander. Find you out of bed, for I upon this bank will rest my head.
One turf shall serve as pillow for us both, one heart, one bed, two bosoms, and one shrew.
Nay! Good Lysander, for my sake, my dear, lie further off yet. Do not lie so near.
Oh, take the sense, sweet, of my innocence. Love takes the meaning in love's conference. I mean that my heart unto yours is knit, so that but one heart we can make of it. Two bosoms, interchained with an oath? So then two bosoms and a single troth. Then by your side no bedroom me deny. For lying so, Hermia, I do not lie.
Lysander riddles very prettily. Now, much beshrew my manners and my pride, if Hermia meant to say Lysander lied, but, gentle friend, for love and courtesy lie further off in human modesty. Such separation, as may well be said, becomes a virtuous bachelor and a maid. So, Barbie descent, and good night, sweet friend. Thy love ne'er alter till thy sweet life end.
Oh, amen. Amen to that fair prayer, say I, and then end life when I end loyalty. Here is my bed. Sleep give thee all his rest.
With half that wish the wisher's eyes be pressed.
Through the forest have I gone. But Athenian found I none of whose eyes I might approve this forest forth. Stirring love. I can silence. Who is here? If I can see doth where. This is he, my master said! Despised the Athenian maid! Maiden sleeping sand on the dank and dirty ground. Oh, pretty soul. Churl, upon thine eyes I throw all the power that this charm doth owe. When thou wak'st, let love forbid. Sleep he sinks on thy eyelid. Oh, so wake when I am gone. I must now to Oberon.
Stay, little
kill me, sweet Demetrius!
I charge thee hence, do not haunt me thus!
Oh, but thou darkly leave me, do not so!
Stay on thy peril, I alone will go!
Oh, I am out of breath in this fond chase! The more my prayer, the lesser is my grace. Oh, happy is Hermia, wheresoe'er she lies, for she hath blessed and attractive eyes. But who's here? Lysander, on the ground, dead or asleep? I see no blood, no wound. Lysander, if you live, good sir, awake.
And run through fire I will for thy sweet sake. Transparent Helena, nature shows art that through thy bosom makes me see thy heart. Where's Demetrius? Oh, how fit a word is that vile name to perish on my sword!
Do not say so, Lysander, say not so. What though he love your Hermia? Lord, what though? Yet Hermia still loves you, then be content.
Content with Hermia? No, I do repent the tedious minute I would perhaps spent. Not Hermia, but Helena I love. Who will not change a raven for a dove? The will of man is by his reason swayed, and reason says you are the worthier maid.
Wherefore was I to this keen mockery born? When at your hands did I deserve this scorn? It's not enough, it's not enough, young man, that I did never, no, nor never can deserve a sweet look from Demetrius' eye, but you must flout my insufficiency. That a lady of one man refused should of another man be abused!
What?
She sees not Hermia. Hermia, sleep thou there, and never mayest thou come Lysander near. And all my powers address your love and might to honor Helen and to be her knight! Oh! Helena! 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 You're not just who I love, you're who I am! Helena!
Help me, Lysander. Men, help me.
Oh, do thy best to pluck this crawling serpent from my breast! By me, for pity, what a dream was here. Lysander, look how I do quake with fear. Methought a serpent ate my heart away, and you sat smiling at his cruel prey. Lysander? What? Remove that? Lysander! Lord! What out of hearing? Gone, no sound, no word! Alack, where are you? Speak, and if you hear, speak of all love. I swoon almost with fear. No? And I well perceive that you are not nigh. Either death or you I'll find immediately. Lysander! Lysander!
That will never please. First, Pyramus must draw a sword and kill himself, which the ladies cannot abide. How answer you that?
By your lake in a parlous fear.
I believe we must leave the killing out when all is done.
Not a whit. I have a device to make all well. write me a prologue, and let the prologue seem to say that we will do no harm with our swords, and that Pyramus is not killed indeed. And, for the more better assurance, tell them that I, Pyramus, am not Pyramus, but Bottom the Weaver. This will put them out of fear.
Well, we will have such a prologue.
Will not the ladies be afeard of the lion?
I fear it, I promise you.
Masters, you ought to consider with yourself to bring in God shield us. A lion among ladies is a most dreadful thing, for there is no more fearful, wild, foul than your lion living, and we ought to look to it.
Therefore, another prologue must tell he is not a lion.
Nay, you must name his name, and half his face must be seen through the lion's neck, and he should speak through, saying thus, or to the same defect. Ladies?
Ladies?
Fair ladies, I would wish you, I would request you, I would entreat you not to fear, not to tremble, my life for yours. If you think I come hither as a lion, it were a pity on my life. I am a man, as other men are, and there indeed let him name his name and tell them plainly he is...
Snug the Joiner!
That shall be, but there is two hard things, that is, to bring the moonlight into a chamber, for, you know, Pyramus and Thisbe meet by moonlight.
No.
Spin's over.
Doth the moon shine the night we play our play?
Yes! It doth shine that night!
Sorry.
Or else one must come in with a bush of thorns and a lanthorn and say she comes to disfigure. To present the person of Moonshine. Then there is another thing. We must have a wall in the great chamber, for Pyramus and Thisbe, says the story, did pass through a chink of the wall.
You can never bring in a wall. What say you, Bottom?
Bottom! Hey, some man or other must present the wall, and let him have some loam and some plaster and some rough cast about him to signify wall, and then let him hold his fingers in, thus, and through that cranny shall the lovers, Pyramus and Thisbe,
whisper.
Oh, yes. Whisper.
If that may be, then all is well. Come, sit down, every mother's child.
What hempen homespuns have we swaggering here? So near the cradle of the fairy queen. What? A play towards? Ooh, I'll be an auditor. An actor too, perhaps, if I see cause.
Thisbe. The flowers of odious savor. Odors savor sweet. So hath thy breath, my dearest Thisbe dear. But hark, I hear a voice. Stay thou but here a while, and by I will to thee appear.
A stranger Pyramus that e'er played here.
You've been dating since high school.
Aye, Mary, must you fall? You must understand. He goes but to see a noise he hath heard. And is to come again.
Yes.
Most free!
most lovely Jew.
Yeah.
As true as horse that yet would never fire on me the nervous and
easy. Snidest assume, man, why you must not speak all that yet? That you answer unto Pyramus? You speak all your part at once, cues and all. Pyramus, enter, your cue is past. It is the third tiger.
As true as horse that yet would never fire.
Yeehaw! If I were fair, this be I were only thine.
Oh, strange, we are haunted! Pray,
master, supply! Sometimes! Sometimes fire!
Why do they run away? This is a knavery to make me appear.
The boat, Tom!
Bottom!
Thou art changed! What do I see on thee?
What do you see? Do you see an asset of your own, do you?
Bless thee, Bottom! Bless thee! Thou art... translated!
I see their knavery. This is to make an ass of me. And to fright me if they could. But I will walk up and down and I will sing to show that I am not afraid. The woozle cock so black of hue, with orange tawny bill, the throstle with his note so true, the wren with little quill.
What angel wakes me from my flowery bed?
The wren, the sparrow, and the lark, the plain song cuckoo gray, whose note full many a man doth mark and dare not answer. Nay!
I pray thee, gentle mortal.
Sing again, mine ears, much enamored of thy note.
So is mine eye enthralled into thy sheep, and thy fair virtue's force perforce does move me on the first view to say, to swear, I love thee!
Oh, methinks, mistress, you should have little reason for that. Yet, to speak the truth, reason and love keep little company together nowadays.
Thou art as wise as thou art beautiful!
Not so neither. But if I had wit enough to get out of this wood, I have enough to serve mine own turn.
Out of this wood? Do not desire to go! Thou shalt remain here, whether thou wilt or no! I am a spirit of no common rate. Summer still doth tend upon my state, and I do love thee. Therefore, go with me. I will give thee fairies to attend on thee, and I will purge thy mortal grossness so that thou shalt, like an airy spirit, go. Peace blossom, cobweb, moat, and mustard seed.
And I? Where shall we go?
Kind and courteous to this gentleman, humble in his walks and gamble in his eyes. Feed him with apricots and dewberries, with purple grapes, green figs, and mulberries. Nod to him, elves, and do him courtesies.
Hail, mortal!
Oh, hail!
I cry your worship mercy heartily. Your name, honest gentleman?
Cobweb.
Oh, I shall require you of greater company, my good Master Cobweb. Oh, and your name, good Mistress
Peas Blossom.
Oh, good Mistress Peas Blossom. Pray commend me to your mother, Mistress Squash, and your father, Master Peas God. Oh, and your name, honest gentlewoman? Oh, good Mistress Mustard Seed. I promise you, your kindred have made mine eyes water ere now. I shall desire you a better acquaintance, good Mistress Mustard Seed.
Wait upon him. Bring him to my bower. Tie up my lover's tongue. Bring him silently.
Did I pull your head off? Oh.
I won one, but not the last one.
I wonder if Titania be awake. Then, what next came in her eye which she must dote on in extremity? Here comes my messenger. Welcome, wanderer. What night rule now about this haunted grove?
Oh, my mistress with the monsters in love! Near to her close and consecrated bower, while she was in her dull and sleeping hour, a crew of patches, rude mechanicals that were for bread upon Athenian stalls, were met here to rehearse a play, intended for the great Theseus's nuptial day. The shallowest thick skin of that barren sword who Pyramus presented in their sport forsook his scene and entered in a break. When I did him at this advantage take, an ass's null I fixed on his head! Oh, and on his Thisbe must be answered. And forth my mimic comes. When they him spy, so at his sight, away his fellows fly! I led them in this distracted fear, and their sweet Pyramus translated there. So in that moment, so it came to pass, Titania waked and straightway loved in us.
This fool sounds better than I could devise. But hast thou yet latched the Athenian's eyes with the love juice, as I did bid thee do?
I took him sleeping. That is finished too. And the Athenian woman by his side when he waked up. Oh, she must be eyed.
Stand close. This is the same Athenian.
Ah, this is the woman, but not this the man.
Oh, why rebuke you him that loves you so? Lay breath so bitter on your bitter foe.
Now I but chide, but I should do thee worse, for thou, I fear, hast given me cause to curse. If thou hast slain Lysander in his sleep, being or shoes in blood, plunge in the deep and kill me too!
Huh?
It cannot be but thou hast murdered him. So should a murderer look so dead, so grim!
So should the murdered look, and so should I, pierced through the heart with your stern cruelty. You spent your passions on a misprized mood. I am not guilty of Lysander's blood. Nor is he dead, for aught I can tell.
I pray thee, tell me then that he is well.
Then if I could,
whoa!
What should I get there for?
Death!
Oh!
A privilege never to see me more! Then from thy hated presence part I so. See me no more, whether he be dead or no!
Oh. There is no following her in this fierce vein. Here, therefore, for a while, I will remain.
What hast thou done? Thou hast mistaken quite and laid the love juice on some true love sight. About
oh.
Go swifter than the wind and Helena of Athens, look thou find. By some illusion, see thou bring her here. I'll charm his eyes against she do appear.
I go. Look how I go, swifter than arrow from the Tartar's bow!
Flower of this purple dye, hit with Cupid's archery, sink in apple of his eye. When his love he doth espy, let her shine as gloriously as the Venus of the sky. When thou wak'st, if she be by, beg of her for remedy.
Captain of our fairy band! Helena is here at hand. And the youth mistook by me, pleading for lover's fee. Ooh, shall we their fond pageant see? Lord, what fools these mortals be.
Stand aside. The noise they make will cause Demetrius to awake.
Then two of you, one at once. That must needs be sport alone. And these things best do please me that befall preposterously.
Why should you think that I should ruin scorn? Scorn and derision never come in tears. Look, when I vow I weep, and vow so born in their nativity, all truth appears.
Your vows to her and me put in two scales will even weigh, and both as light as two.
I had no judgment when to her I swore.
Nor none in my mind, now you give her o'er.
Demetrius loves her, and he loves me too.
Oh. Helen, goddess, nymph, perfect, divine, to what, my love, shall I compare thine eye? Crystal! Crystal is muddy! Oh, how ripe and show thy lips, thy kissing cherries tempting grow.
Husband! Oh, hell! I see you all are bent to set against me for your merriment. If you were men, as men you are in show, you would not use a gentle lady so to vow and swear and super praise my parts when I am sure you hate me with your hearts. You both are rivals and love Hermia, and now both rivals to mock Helena?
You are unkind, Demetrius. Look, be not so. For you love Hermia, as you know it here, with all goodwill, with all my heart, and Hermia's love, I yield you up my part. And yours of Helena to me, queen, who I do love and held you to my death.
Never did mockers waste more idle breath.
My sister! Hermia, I will none. If ever I loved her, all that love is gone. My heart has a guest wise, so dark. And now is home returned to Helen, there to remain.
Oh, Helen, it is not so.
Disparage not the faith thou dost not know, lest to thy peril thou abide here. Come,
why should he stay?
Love doth press to come.
What love could press Lysander from my side?
Lysander's love that would not let him bide. Fair Helena, who more engilds the night than all yon fiery arms and eyes of light. Why seekest thou me? Could not this make thee know the hate I bear thee made me leave thee so?
You speak not as you think it cannot be.
Lo! She is one of this confederacy. Now I perceive they have conjoined all three to fashion this false sport in spite of me. Injurious Hermia, most ungrateful maid, have you conspired? Have you with these contrived to bait me with this foul derision? Is all the counsel that we two have shared, the sister's vows, oh, is all forgot? All school days friendship, childhood innocence, and will you rent our ancient love asunder to join with men in scorning your poor friend?
I am amazed at your passionate words. I scorn you not. It seems that you scorn me.
Have you not set Lysander as in scorn to praise my eyes and face? And made your other love, Demetrius, who even but now did spurn me with his foot to call me goddess, nymph, divine, and rare.
I understand not what you mean by this.
I do. Counterfeit dead looks make mouths upon me when I turn my back, wink each at other, hold the sweet jest up, but fare ye well.
'Tis partly mine own fault, which death or absence soon shall remedy.
Hey, gentle Helena, hear my excuse, my love, my life, my soul, fair Helena.
No!
Excellent! Sweet! Do not scorn her so!
If she cannot entreat, I can compel!
Thou canst compel no more than she entreat. Thy threats have more strength than her weak prayers. Helen, I love thee, by my life, I do!
I say I love thee more than he can do!
If thou say so, withdraw and prove it too!
Quick, come!
Lysander, where to come all this?
Oh, hang off, thou cat!
Thou whore, vile thing, let loose! I'll shake thee from me like a serpent!
Why are you grown so rude? What change is this, sweet love?
Thy love, out, tiny torture! Out, loathed medicine! Out, hated potion!
Do you not jest?
Yes, sooth, and so do you!
Demetrius, I'll keep my word with thee!
I would have had your bond, for I perceive a weak bond holds you. I'll not take your word.
Oh, what, shall I hurt her? Strike her, kill her dead? Although I hate her, I'll not harm her so.
What? Can you do me greater harm than hate me? Wherefore, O me, what knows my love? Since night you left me, and since night you left me. Why then you left me, oh, the gods forbid, in earnest, shall I say.
Aye, by my life. And never did desire to see thee more. Therefore, be out of hope, of question, of doubt. Be certain, nothing truer, 'tis no jest. That I do hate thee and love Helena.
Back off.
Oh, me? You juggler. Oh, you tanker blossom, you thief of love, what?
Have you come by night and stolen my love's heart from him?
Fine, in faith. Have you no modesty? No maiden shame, no touch of bashfulness? What? Will you tear impatient answers from my gentle tongue?
Fine, fine!
You counterfeit, you puppet, you!
Puppet! Why? So I that way goes the game. Now I perceive that she hath made compare between our statures. She hath urged her height, and with her personage, her tall personage, her height. Forsooth, she hath prevailed with him.
No.
And are you grown so high in his esteem because I am so dwarfish and so low? How low am I, thou painted maypole? Spider! How low am I? I am not yet so low, but that my nails can reach unto thine own!
I was never cursed. I have no gift at all in shrewishness. I am a right maid for my cowardice. You perhaps may think because she is something lower than myself that I can match her.
Lower?
Hermia! Do not be so bitter with me! However more did love you, Hermia! Now, so you will let me quiet go to Athens while I bear my folly back and follow you no further. Let me go! You see how simple and how fond I am.
Why get you gone? Who is that hinders you?
A foolish heart that I leave here behind.
What? With Lysander.
With Demetrius.
Be not afraid. She shall not harm me.
No, she shall not. You take her place.
Oh, when she is angry, she is keen and shrewd. She was a vixen when she went to school. And though she be but little, she is fierce.
Little and but low and little.
No.
To flout me thus. Let me come to her!
Yes, you swan, you swan! You minimus of hindering, not glass maid! You bead, you acorn!
You are too officious in her behalf that scorns your services. Let her alone! Speak not of Helena, take not her part. For if thou dost intend never so little show of love to her, thou shalt abide!
Now she holds me not! Now follow, if thou darest, to try whose right of thine or mine is most in Helena.
Follow, nay, I'll go with thee, cheek by jowl!
You, mistress, all this coil is
is long of you. Nay, go not back.
I will not trust you. I no longer stay in your cursed company. Your hands than mine are quicker for a fray. My legs are longer than to run away.
I am amazed and know not what to say. Helena! Oh! Helena! Yes.
This is thy negligence. Still thou mistakes, or else committest thy knavery's will.
Believe me, King of Shadows, I mistook. Did not you tell me I should know the man by the Athenian garments he had on?
Thou seest these lovers seek a place to fight. Hie, therefore, Robin, overcast the night, and lead these testy rivals so astray that one come not within the other's way. Like to Lysander, sometimes frame thy tongue, then stir Demetrius up with bitter wrong, and sometimes rail thou like Demetrius, and from each other look thou lead them thus, till o'er their eyes, death counterfeiting sleep, with leaden legs and fatty wings doth creep. Then crush this herb into Lysander's eye, whose liquor hath this virtuous property, to take from thence all error with his might, and make his eyeballs roll with wonted sight. When next they wake, all this derision shall seem a dream and fruitless vision. But notwithstanding, haste, make no delay. We may effect this business yet ere day.
Up and down, up and down. I will lead them up and down. I am feared and filled in town. Oh, goblin, lead them up and down. Oh, here comes one.
Where art thou, proud Demetrius? Speak thou now.
Here, villain, drawn and ready. Where art thou?
I'll be with thee straight.
Follow me then to plainer ground.
Bender, speak. Thou run away? Thou coward, art thou fled? Speak again, in some bush. Where dost thou hide thy head?
Thou coward, why art bragging to the stars, thou telling the bushes thou looks for wars and wilt not come?
Yea, art thou there?
Follow my voice, we'll try no manhood here.
Me, it still tears me on. When that cavalry calls, then he is gone! Oh. The villain is much lighter shield than I. I followed fast, but faster he could fly. I've fallen in my dark, uneven way. And here will rest me. Oh, come, thou gentle day. For but once thou show me thy gray light. I'll find Demetrius, your avengers.
Oh, coward! Why comest thou not?
Abide me if thou darest, for well I want the rest before me, shifting every place, will not stand nor look me in the face. Where is that man?
Come hither! I am here!
Nay then, thou mockst me. Thou shalt buy this steer if ever I thy face by daylight see. Now go thy way. Fate this constraineth me to measure out my length upon this cold bed. My day's approach, look to me, visited!
A weary night. Long and tedious night. Bid thy hours shine comforts from the east that I may back to Athens by daylight. From these that my poor company detest, and sleep, which sometimes shuts up sorrow's eye, steal me a while from mine own company.
Yet but three, come one more, two of both kinds make up four. Oh, here she is. Cursed and sad, Cupid is a knavish lad, thus to make poor females mad.
Oh, never so weary, never so in woe bedabbled with dew and torn with briars. I can no further crawl, no further go. My legs can keep no pace with my desires. Here will I rest me till the break of day. Heaven shield Lysander if they mean a fray.
On the ground, sleep sound. I'll apply to your eye, gentle lover, remedy. When thou wakest, thou takest true delight in the former lady's eye. Jack shall have Jill, nut shall go ill, the man shall have his mare again, and all shall be well.
Blossom, where's Cobweb? Where's Mistress Mustard Seed?
Oh,
give me your niece, good Mistress Mustard Seed.
Oh, what's your
mind? And nothing but to help Calvary Cobweb but to scratch. I must to the barber's, for I feel I am marvelous hairy about the face, and I am such a tender ass, and my hair do but tickle me, I must scratch.
Say, sweet love, what thou desirest to eat?
Oh, truly, a peck of provender. I could munch your good dry oats. But methinks I have a great desire for a bottle of hay. Oh, good hay, sweet hay, hath no fellow. But I pray you, have none of your people stir me, for I have a great exposition of sleep come upon me.
Sleep thou, and I'll wind thee in my arms. O fairies, be gone, and be always away. So doth the woodbine the sweet honeysuckle gently entwist, the female ivy sew and ring the barky finger of the elm. Oh, how I love thee, how I dote on thee.
Welcome, good Robin. Seest thou this sweet sight? Her dotage now I do begin to pity, for meeting her of late behind the wood, seeking sweet favors from this hateful fool, I did upbraid her and fall out with her. When I had at my pleasure taunted her, and she in mild terms begged my patience, I then did ask of her her changeling child, which straight she gave me, and sent her fairy to bear him to my bower in fairyland. And now I have the boy. I will undo this hateful imperfection in her eyes. And, gentle pup, take this transformed scout from off the head of this Athenian swain, that he awaking when the others do, may all to Athens back again repair, and think no more of this night's accidents, but as the fierce vexation of a dream. But first, I will release the fairy queen. Be as thou wast wont to be. See as thou wast wont to see. Dyad's bud, or Cupid's flower, hath such force and blessed power. And now, my Titania, wake you, my sweet queen.
My Oberon! Oh, what visions have I seen! Methought I was enamored of... of an ass!
Oh, there lies your love.
How may these things to pass? Oh, how am I not to love his visage now?
Silence a while. Pop, take off his head. Titania, music call.
Music, hell, music, such a charming sleep.
Now when thou wakes, then open these eyes.
Now you and I are new in amity, and will tomorrow midnight solemnly dance in Duke Theseus's house triumphantly.
Sir King, attend and mark. I do hear the morning lark.
Come, my lord, and in our flight. Tell me how it came this night that I sleeping here was found with these mortals on the ground.
Sound music! Come, my queen, take hands with me, and rock the ground whereon these sleepers be.
Sky
since we have the forward of the day, my love shall hear the music of my hounds. We will, fair queen, up to the mountain's top and mark the musical confusion of hounds and echo in conjunction.
I was with Hercules and Cadmus once, when in a wood of Crete they bade the bear with hounds of Sparta. I never heard so musical a discord, such sweet thunder!
My hounds are bred out of the Spartan kind! Judge when you hear. The soft, what nymphs are these?
My lord, this is my daughter here asleep. And this Lysander. Here Demetrius is, and Helena, old Nadar's Helena. I wonder if they're being here together.
No doubt they rose up early to observe the rite of May, and hearing our intent, came here in grace of our solemnity. But speak, Aegeus, is not this the day that Hermia should give answer of her choice?
It is, my lord.
Who's up there? Who's up here?
Good morrow, friends! St. Valentine is past! Begin these woodbirds but the couple now?
Pardon, my lord!
Do we what?
I pray you all stand up!
Just kind of like, barely is coming.
I know you two are rival enemies. How comes this gentle concord in the world?
My lord, I shall reply amazedly, half sleep, half waking, but as yet, I swear, I cannot truly say how I came here.
Let's go back to the time.
But as I think, for truly would I speak, and now do I bethink me, so it is. I came with Hermia hither. Our intent was to be gone from Athens, where we might without the peril
enough,
of the Athenian...
Enough, my lord! You have enough! The law upon his head. They would have stolen away. They would have, Demetrius.
My lord...
I watched how the Grinch...
Fair Helen told me of their stealth, of this their purpose hither to this wood, and in fury hither I followed them, Helena and Fancy following me. But, my lord, my love to Hermia melted as the snow. Seems to me now as the remembrance of an idol god which in my childhood I did dote upon, all the faith, all the virtue of my heart, the object and pleasure of mine eye is only Helena. To her, my lord, Lord, was I betrothed ere I saw Hermia.
Fair lovers, who are fortunately met. Aegeus, I will overbear your will, for in the temple, by and by with us, these couples shall eternally be knit. Away with us to Athens, three and three, we'll hold a feast of great solemnity. Okay. Come, Hippolyta!
These things seem small and undistinguishable, like far-off mountains turned into clouds.
Oh, methinks I see these things with parted eye when everything seems double.
So methinks, and I have found Demetrius like a jewel. Mine own and not mine own.
Are you sure that we are awake? It seems to me now that yet we sleep, we dream.
Do not you think the Duke was just here and bid us follow him?
Yea, and my father.
And Hippolyta.
And he did bid us follow to the temple. Why then we are awake? Let's follow, and by the way, let us recount our dreams.
But when my cue comes, call me and I will answer.
My next is most fair, fearless.
Hello. Peter Quince?
Thank
you. Flute the bellows, Minder? It's not the tinker, Starveling? Odds my life. Stolen hints and left me asleep. I have had a most rare vision. I have had a dream beyond the wit of any man to say what dream it was. Man is but an ass if he go about to expound this dream. Thought I was. No man can say what he thought I was. He thought I was, and me thought I had. Man is but a patch fool to say what me thought I had. The eyes of man cannot hear, the ears of man cannot see, man's hands cannot taste, his tongue conceive, nor his heart report what my dream was. I will get Peter Quince to write a ballad of this dream. It should be called Bottom's Dream. For it hath no bottom.
Not, then the play is marred. It goes not forward, doth it?
No, it is not possible. You have no man through all Athens to discharge Pyramus, but he...
No. He hath simply the best wit of any handicraft worker in Athens.
Yea, and the best person, too. And he is a very paramour for a sweet voice.
You must say pair are gone. A paramour is, God bless us, a thing of naught.
Masters! Masters! The Duke comes from the temple, and there is two or three more lords and ladies married! And our sport got forward! We had been made men! Oh, sweet Bully Bottom! Thus had he lost sixpence a day during his life, and the Duke had not given him sixpence a day to play Pyramus. I'll be hanged!
Where are these lads? Oh, masters,
I am to discourse wonders.
What? Oh, but ask me not what.
Oh, let us hear, sweet Bottom.
Not a word of me. All I will say is that the Duke hath dined. Get your apparels together. Every man look o'er his part, for the short and the long of it is, our play is preferred.
Dear actors, eat no onions or garlic,
for we are to utter a sweet breath, and I doubt not but to hear them say, it is a sweet comedy.
No more words. Away, go away.
So close.
Thank you.
Speak of.
More strange than truth. I never may believe these antique fables nor these fairy toys. Such tricks have strong imaginations that if it would apprehend some joy, it comprehends some bringer of that joy. Or in the night, imagining some fear, how easy is a bush supposed to bear?
But all the story of the night told over, and all their minds transfigured so together, it grows to something of great constancy.
Look, here come the lovers, full of joy and mirth. Joy, gentle friends, joy and fresh days of love accompany your heart.
More than to us, wait in your royal walks, your board, your bed. Cheers.
Cheers.
Come, what masks, what dances shall we have to wear away the long age of 3 hours between our after supper and bedtime? Bedtime. Yes. Say, what abridgment have you for this evening?
A tedious brief scene of young Pyramus and his love Thisbe. Very tragical mirth.
Merry and tragical. Tedious and brief. This is hot ice and wondrous strange snow.
There is a play, my lord, some 10 words long, which is as brief as I have known a play. But by 10 words, my lord, it is too long.
Which makes it tedious.
For in all the play, there is not 1 word apt, 1 player fitted. And tragical it is, my lord, for therein Pyramus doth kill himself, which, when I saw rehearsed, I must confess, made mine eyes water. But,
or merry tears, the passion of loud laughter never shed.
What are they that do play?
Hard-handed men that work in Athens here.
And we will hear it.
Come on, my lord, it is not for you.
I have heard it over, it is nothing.
I will hear that play. Go, bring them forth, and take your place, late.
He says they can do nothing in this kind.
The kind are we to give them thanks for nothing.
So please, your grace, the prologue is addressed.
Let him approach.
Yes,
Miss Fine.
No man wonder. This woman with Landthorn Dog and Bush of Thorn is by Moonshine. Or if you want to know, by Moonshine. Moonshine. Pick no score to meet. And nine is tomb there. To woo. This grizzly beast, the lion type, what? By name of Trusty, just be jerk, and I can get away, or rather get a fight. And as she fled, a mantle she did fall. Where by and by with bloody mouth did stay. Hope and on, I was fearless, leave you and hope. And find, tis Trusty, tis these mantles slain. Whereat with bloody blade, full blade, he bravely broached his boiling bloody breast. And she's be tearing and maul, very shame.
Oh, no.
His dagger drew, and die.
I wonder if the lion
can. No wonder, my lord, one lion may with many asses do.
In this same interlude, it doth befall that I, one Snout by name, present
a wall.
And such a
wall
as I would have you think that had in it a crannied hole or chink, through which the lovers, Pegasus and Ditsy, did whisper often, very secretly. This loam, this rough cast, and this stone doth show that I am that same
wall.
The truth is so, and this the cranny is right and sinister, through which the fearful lovers are to whisper.
Would you desire lime and hair to speak better?
It is the wittiest partition that ever I heard discourse, my lord.
Pyramus draws near the wall. Silence.
Oh, grim look, knight. Oh, knight with hue so black. Oh, knight, whichever our twin day is not. Oh, knight. Oh, knight. Alack, alack, alack. I fear my Thisbe's promise is forgot. And thou, oh, wall. Oh, sweet, oh, lovely wall.
Stop.
That stands between her father's ground and mine. Thou, O wall, O sweet, O lovely wall, show me thy chink, just blink through with thine eyes. Thanks, courteous wall, Jove shield thee well for this. What see I? No Thisbe do I see. Oh, wicked wall, through whom I see no bliss. Cursed be thy stones for thus deceiving me!
Oh, yeasted cracker blossom!
Oh, all methinks being sensible should curse again!
No, sir, in truth he should not. Deceiving me is Thisbe's cue. She is to enter now.
Oh, wall! Oh, wall!
Oh, Martin! Hast thou heard my moans for parting my fair Pyramus? Annie, my lily lips have often kissed thy stones. Thy stones with lime and hang it up in thee.
But hark, I see a voice. Now will I to the wall and spy, and I can hear my Thisbe's face. Thisbe.
My love thou art, my love I think.
Oh, think what thou wilt. I am thy lover's grace. Will thou kiss me through the hole of this vile wall?
I kiss the wall's hole, not your lips at all.
Wilt thou at Ninny's tomb meet me straight away?
Tight life! Tight death! I come without delay!
Thus have I, wall, my part discharged so. And being done, this wall away doth go.
This is the silliest stuff that ever I heard.
Oh, here come two noble beasts, a man and a lion. Oh,
you ladies, you, whose tender hearts do fear the smallest monstrous mouse that creeps. On floor. May now, perchance, to quake and tremble here when lion, rock in wildest rage, doth roar!
Kitty!
Oh, God!
Yes. Moses. Oh. Okay. All right. Then know that I, one Snug the Joiner, am no lion fell, nor else no lion's dam. For if as lion I should come in strife into this place, twere pity on my life.
Very gentle beast and of good conscience.
Very best of the beasts, my lord, that e'er I saw.
This, my headline, that the horn moon presents.
She should have worn the horns on her head.
Wait. That this lanthorn doth the horn moon present. My self and the man in the moon do seem to be.
Well, that's the greatest error of all the rest. The man should be put into the lanthorn. How else is it the man in the moon?
I am aweary of this moon. Would she would change?
All I have to say is to tell you that the lanthorn is the moon. Myself, the man in the moon. This turbus, not the bus. This dog, my dog. Thank you. Thank you.
And then came Tisby.
This is old Minnie's tomb. Where is my love?
Aww.
Oh, I'm scared. Scared lion.
Well roared lion.
Well run, Tisby.
Well showed moon. Truly the moon shines with a good grace.
Well moused lion.
And then came Pyramus.
And so the lion vanished.
Hey, sweet moon, I thank thee for thy sunny beams. I thank thee, moon, for shining now so bright. Thank thee for thy golden, glittering, gleaming gleams. I trust to take of truest Thisbe's sight. Oh, but stay. Oh, spite. But mark, poor knight, what dreadful doll is here? Eyes, do you see? How can it be? Oh, dainty duck, oh dear! Her mantle glued, what? Stained with blood. Oh! Approach, ye furies fell! Oh, fates, come, cut thread and thrum, quail, crush, conclude! And quail.
This passion and death of a dear friend will go near to make a man look sad.
Beshrew my heart, but I pity the man. You know,
wherefore, nature, didst thou lion frame, since lion vile hath here deflowered my dear, which is, which was the fairest dame that ever lived, that loved, that liked, that looked with cheer. Oh, come tears confound, outsword and wound. That path of Pyramus, aye, that left path where heart doth hop, thus die I. Oh, thus, no! Thus, oh, thus, oh. Oh. And now, now am I dead. Now am I fled, my soul is in the sky. Tongue, lose thy light. Moon, take thy flight.
Thank you.
Now, die, oh, die, oh, for die, oh, die, oh, die.
He might yet recover and prove himself an ass.
How chance moonshine is gone before Thisbe comes back and finds her lover?
She will find him by starlight. There she comes. And her passion ends the play.
Sleeping, my love?
cherry lips. this lily nose, these yellow cowslip cheeks are gone! Are gone! Lovers, make moon!
That's awkward! That's great, Flakes!
Tongue, not a word! Contrusty sword! Trusty sword! Trusty sword! Trusty sword! Trusty sword! Come, blade! My breast! My breast and
the wall is down that parted their parents.
Oh, and,
would it please you to see the epilogue?
No! No epilogue, I pray you. For your play needs no excuse. Let your epilogue look.
Thank you.
Yes. Good job. Good job.
It's down here.
The iron tongue of midnight hath told 12. Lovers to bed, tis almost fairy time. A fortnight hold we this solemnity in nightly revels and new jollity.
If the dagger have offended, think but this, and all is mended. That you have but slumbered here while these visions did appear. And this week, an idle dream, you'll be nothing more than a dream. Gentles, do not reprehend. If you pardon, we will mend. And as I am an honest puck, if we have unearned luck, now to scape the serpent's tongue ere long, we will make amends ere long. Else the puck, a liar call. And so good night until you all. Give me your hands if we be friends. And Roman shall be sermon!
Thank you.
everybody's here and accounted for. So I'm really happy to have this job because I don't have any lines to memorize. And all I am going to do is invite you to ask any questions you want of the actors and the director and maybe director slash choreographer slash gymnastics teacher. The set people, the costumes, the music, anything you want to ask at all. And what I do is carry this microphone around so that whatever question you ask, others can hear. And I will have to sort of do my best. And it's very difficult to see looking. They can't see you at all. Isn't that right? You can barely see anyone when you're acting. So who will be the first person to ask a question? Raise your hand. And help me spot. I need a spotter. I need a hand. Somebody raise their hand. Here's a hand right here. All right.
What's your question?
You're
done.
This is going to be a simultaneous translation, child to mother.
Yeah. How many years did it take to get good at what you do?
Anybody want to answer that one?
still trying to get good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, personally for me, what a lot of stuff I do in the show is new to me. I had to learn all of the stuff that we do in the show, all the acro balance and all that kind of stuff. I had to learn in the past couple weeks that we've been doing this, and it's really been an exciting process for me personally in that way.
And I'm going to chime in, though, because, well, this is Dylan, also known as Cobweb. While that's true to some degree, I mean, it's been months, not weeks, that we've been working on it, but that while, you know, there are certain things that we ask of some of the performers that were new to them, everyone here has training. And so someone like Dylan has training as an actor and dance training. And, you know, someone who has an innate talent or skill, we try to identify, like as a choreographer, that's one of my challenges is to, through the casting process and then in the beginning of rehearsals, is to identify people's skill sets, identify where their strengths are, but also where their potential is, and to push that so that, you know, folks are out here able to give you their best.
Okay. All right, who else would like to ask a question of this merry band of players? Down here. All right.
That's right.
Is there a model that you used for all the acrobatics and everything? I just want to thank you for how magical your production is. It's my second night here, and it's magic. Thank you. And yeah, yay. And if it's not, you guys are the model.
Right. Well, you know, there's no specific model, but, you know, I've been doing both circus and theater for many years, generally separately. And somehow last fall I felt like, oh, this year we need to do Midsummer and we need to have fairies that are up in the air and it needs to be all set in a circus. And the magical world of Midsummer is the magical world of the circus and the forest in the circus and the circus in the forest. And so we assembled this awesome cast of actors and acrobats and aerialists, and we actually had separate auditions for the actors and for the circus performers.
There was crossover,
but we, you know, people who wanted to be considered as for fairies needed to do the acrobatic and the circus audition as well. So I don't know if anybody else wants to talk to any of that process.
I was just wondering, the Pyramus and Thisbe was terrific. I haven't laughed so hard in years. And I saw some Monty Python in there, and I saw some. Where do you get these ideas? It's marvelous.
Well,
we just kind of figure it out during rehearsal, and we push each other's boundaries, and just kind of see where each other are comfortable, and then go past that. And Dick, he would often say, you know, more, even far, you know, push it even farther, and it got to where it is now. Okay. And yeah, it's pretty fun.
Okay, let's see. You're raising your hand, but you're just shaking a stick at the tree.
Oh.
Okay, all right.
I like you.
Somebody else raise a hand? Somebody have a question? We have a quiet group here tonight. Yes, here.
Congratulations, you guys. You did such a wonderful performance. I was captivated. It was fantastic. Kudos to you guys. My question was, what was the rehearsal process like? Because I know you mentioned some of your dancing and your acrobatics, but I'm just curious kind of what your journey was getting to this point.
Okay. So, at least for me, the rehearsal process was full of a lot of trial and error. There was a lot of cuts, a lot of falling, a lot of bruises, a lot of success, but there was a lot of, it was just a bunch of, like, you gotta keep doing whatever we were told to do a bunch of times until we could get the hang of it, or at least to a point where we could practice it at home, and it was just a lot of, like, physical, and I don't know the words, but it was very,
I guess.
Yeah. Oh, I don't
know. Oh, man.
There we go.
So for example, we had a rehearsal where Dick said, okay, here's this giant cube, and I want you to go play on the cube for 3 hours, and I want you to figure out what you can do on the cube, which ended up on us figuring out that Kalina is a human monkey, and we can just spin the cube while she does amazing things and whatnot. So a lot at the beginning, it was sort of like, let's see what we can do, and we have all these fun things to play with, which resulted in fun and injury, but I'll pass it over to Quinn's.
So I know for the mechanicals, it started out, I think on the first or second day, we did like we met up all together and we just did a bunch of improv games in character, or what we thought it would be like, which is sort of different than the end process. But then we just kind of were blocking out the scenes while playing, and then the more we knew the actual words, we could play even more. So a lot of the stuff, like when I take the stool out from under David in the show, or like Pyramus and Thisbe, a lot of that was just made up in the moment and just kept going from there.
One of the things that I really enjoy about working with Dick as a director, and I've had the privilege of doing that for a number of years, is that he, unlike me as a director, I wasn't directing this piece, but I do direct, I'm a bit more of a detail, like from the beginning, and Dick has an incredible trust in his actors. As you'll know, a lot of this cast is very young, which is an exciting and perfect thing, I think, for this production. Maybe not young, but one of the things that I've watched him do over the years is have, you know, these actors, seasoned actors, come in, and he takes a long time to let them discover. And then when things are going in the direction that feels right, he keeps encouraging that. When it's not, he pulls you back and says, actually, we need to move in this direction. But he allows an extended period of time, in my opinion, for us to explore. If it's not spot on for the vision, he'll let you know, but he usually has enough faith that we will come up with things. You know, it's the synergy of theater that, you know, like someone like Joseph, our musical director, who, you know, really, as again, he deserves applause. You know, something like Joseph, and this is just a little leap, you know, somebody like Joseph, who we've also been working with for a number of years, you know, there will be months and months, you know, prior to this, Dick will say, well, this is my idea. I'm thinking circus. Then he'll leave it with that for a little while. And then again, by the time we get to bringing things to you, Joseph and Tim and Mick, our phenomenal Art Farm Irregular Orchestra, they craft music to what we need, both thematically and mood, but also are very tolerant of again, someone like me who thinks in 8 counts as a choreographer. And he's like, okay, all right, how many 8 counts do you need, Marcella? And oh, but the aerialist doesn't want 8 counts. We want that to be fluid. So you need to work that into the middle. And then Dick has a lot of, you know, punctuation and comic markers. So I guess I feel like, again, working with the team, we as actors are really, eventually, it's like building a playground for us that then we get to swing on. We get to play, not just the literal playground, which is part of that. Thank you, David Schultz and all our builders. But, you know, we really get to swing emotionally and physically and as actors.
Well, the play was really very entertaining. I just loved it. There was a lot of improvisation in the activity and the action of the play, but I'm assuming that all the lines were right out of the play as written. Is that correct?
That's right. There's a few little improvisations, a few extra Helenas and wows and I'm scared here and there, but but about 99% of it is Shakespeare.
And there was no improvisational movement. That was all very, you know.
Yeah, a lot of choreography to create the sense of madness that you see. There has to be a lot of accuracy and consistency that they can repeat every night, or people would be getting hurt. And we left the hurting behind, hopefully, at rehearsal.
I enjoyed the costuming very much, and I was wondering, is this the way you would typically do this this play, you know, with some being contemporary clothes and some being more period clothing? It just tickled me to see the dress on them.
Well, I mean, I think there's probably no typical way of doing this play, and you know, one thing about doing Midsummer Night's Dream is it's obviously one of Shakespeare's most popular plays and most produced, and you are usually performing for an audience, many of whom have seen the play more than once, and kind of come into something like, I'm wondering what they'll do with it this time, because every director, every company sort of takes a different take on this, and one of the things that's great about it as a play is it can just about travel to any time and place and style, and you can find a way to make it work. When we did it 10 years ago, we chose more of, we're in ancient Athens, and you know, the lovers were in togas, and the dress was all much more ancient Athens, and the fairy world was not affected as much by sort of the contemporary circus look, but more reflected kind of wood elves and fairy, you know, a more traditional, natural kind of looking fairy look. So it was just once we kind of made that choice to go into circus, the biggest, I would say, choice that had to be made by the costume designer and with me and the rest of the staff is, are we doing kind of classic circus of the 1930s, or are we looking more at like Cirque du Soleil contemporary circus? And we sort of decided to go with more of a contemporary feel, and I think that, you know, kind of worked with everything here.
What do you think Shakespeare would say about this performance?
He'll say, I've been dead nearly 400 years. Let them do what they want. No, I mean, I would hope that Shakespeare would, you know, appreciate the raucousness and the bawdry that is built into some of our approach. And I don't know, anybody else want to talk to Shakespeare shaking his head at us?
I have a little question. I don't, I'm just curious, and I can't see exactly how many people are out there. Obviously, just a fraction of our bigger audience tonight. But in terms of people here, like, how many of you have seen Midsommar before? I'm just curious. Right. And how many, I guess I'm just curious, like I know that Dick in the pre-show talk briefly mentioned this Shakespeare 400 passport, which you really, if you didn't grab one, you should, because it tells you about all these awesome things that are happening all over the state over the next 10 months that are Shakespeare related. Some of which are art form, but many of which aren't. It was just another brainchild of Dick's. But I'm curious, if you had a good time, does this how many of you does it reinvigorate to sort of say, yeah, it's kind of worth going out to do things like this in my busy, crazy life? I mean, and I don't mean that just for Art Farm. Does this re-excite you about Shakespeare? Awesome. Part of our aim. Thanks for indulging.
I don't think it's going to be this good next time.
Tell the press. Broadway. Right. Well, you know, I'm honestly, you know, we really work hard to get you guys to come. And the best thing that you can do is tell other people. We really appreciate it, you know, because we want to share it.
How about another question from the audience? Sorry. Those of you who've stayed, here we go.
This seemed to be very, very physical play. And are you guys exhausted every single night after you're done?
Yeah.
I mean, I can't believe you're still just sitting there looking awake. It was exhausting to watch you. And but it was amazing. Amazing.
Sorry, Anna, that you can't see well.
I noticed that some of the fairies and some of the characters had evolved definite personalities. And I was curious, during the rehearsal process, how much was this choreographed and how much did you add into your own characters in terms of developing personality and movements that and stylization of your movements that added to what you were doing?
For the longest time, I've always wanted to be Puck, and so when I was offered this, I was so, so excited, and I knew that one day that I wanted to do a darker version of Puck, and so I wanted to take I started with that, and I wasn't sure what to do with it at first, but the more the text, you know, gets in your brain, the more you observe others, the more the mischief kicks in. And I'm also a big fan of animal studies. And so I would start thinking about, okay, what animal am I gonna be? And, you know, how should I, you know, morph into that kind of. And once you figure that out, then I think it pulls all the strings together and you have this character. I mean, that at least that's how my process is. So very animal instinct kind of things. So. Yeah.
Hello, guys. So, for the mechanicals, Dick said in the beginning of our rehearsals was to find a walk, a kind of walk. And I think most of us had found a center. You know, is there center your head? Is it your waist? Like, where do you bend over? Like, I was hunchback most of the time. And that was just a starveling type of character, while Flute was so up straight. You know, you couldn't even poke him over. So, like, each each character, I think, found a center and a walk that really helped evolve our characters to where we were by the end of the show. So, definitely the walk and finding a center definitely helped.
Anybody else have a comment on character?
How did you find your voice, Riley?
I was born with it.
No, but you can come and see Raphael in 12th Night in New Haven in a few weeks' time.
You've got another volunteer to your right, three. Yes, the web mistress.
I have to say that part of the process, like finding our characters and stuff, is just the personal relationships that we all create within the rehearsal process. Like, I know personally, like, that's just a big thing that I like to do is like, we might make a joke backstage, but it can actually translate into what we're doing. Like, you know, like one day Karis and I were talking about, like, joking about, like, picking bugs out of Bottom's head, like in the bower, and then we started playing with it on stage, and then it just kind of stuck. So we, like, that's like a big thing for me, is just the personal relationships that I create with people. Are I like to build on those moments on stage as well.
It's nice watching something like Karis, Mustard Seed, and Emily Peas Blossom, there she is, this funny dynamic that you know, again, I think that one of the choices that Dick made that I feel really works is this like infusion of the fairies in a way that many productions don't choose to do. And I think it's really effective, partly because of who our actors are. But watching, you know, the Karis, our Mustard Seed, who would get frustrated. She would get frustrated, like, from when she first was like, Peas Blossom's getting more attention than I am. And that became kind of a running gag, right? So she would try to climb in the bower, and then Peas Blossom, the head of the fairies, you know, is sort of like, no, you have to be the one. And so she's always and missing out on the luggage. So, like, finding a little kernel like that, then sort of weaving that through, then you get to laugh with it. If it's one time, it's a little funny. But when you start to, you're in on the joke, I think that's one of the things that becomes kind of exciting.
All right, one more question before we roll up our tent, so to speak, and go home for the night.
There's someone way over there, waving their arm.
Way over.
Over to your
there.
Left. By Lloyd, the videographer.
It's staggering how incredibly bright these lights are. Here you go.
Thank you.
Oh, that's a different one.
I don't know how exactly this whole thing works, but I was wondering how you all got involved with Art Farm. I recognized quite a few of you from last year's King Lear. I hope I'm right about recognizing you, but you guys always make me really excited to see your things, and I just wanted to know how you all got involved in this sort of thing.
Thank you.
Totally young, new company in many ways.
Well, I originally actually wasn't part of the production. They had another Lysander that actually had to leave due to medical reasons or something like that. He's okay, but then he's fine. So for me, they had the entire cast had been set, and then they had auditions just for the role of Lysander. And so for me, you know, everyone had already established relationships and who they were. And so I had the fortunate benefit of when I auditioned with my three lovers here. And so it was actually like fun to play with them during the audition, and it was just a lot of fun, and so that was how it was for me.
Actually, a lot of it went to Joni Weisfeld, who cast the whole thing. She's amazing. I think, I mean, that's why I'm here. I was talking to her one day, and she said, "Hey, audition for Art Farm." And I said, "Okay, see you tomorrow." And we did. And then she called me and I said, "Sure, let's do it." So I think a lot of that goes to her.
Allison and I have been working with Dick Wheeler since we were 6 years old. So it's been about 25 years. And we perform in his traveling circus for Fragile Planet. So this was just the next step. He said he's doing this play. Why don't you try it? And there you go. The rest is history. So.
Anything you want to say? No?
Nobody else wants to? Okay.
I actually got involved because the studio that I train at for aerials, I saw the ad up on the wall and it said they were looking for aerialists. And I thought, oh, this was great. This was the next step I wanted to take. And so I came here and at first I thought I bit off way more than I could chew because like, oh, I want you to act as well. I was like, act? I can't act at all. I can hang upside down in the air. But with the support of everybody here and Dick and Marcella, it's been an amazing experience. I'm really glad to be part of this Art Farm family.
Yay. Very fortunate. This is the first time as a director, and I don't know, you know, I've directed 70 plays or something over the last 30 years, but the first time that I didn't cast the play myself, because Marcella and I were in Sri Lanka for 4 months this spring when casting was going on, doing some theater work there, and one of our company members, Joni, held the auditions and did all the casting, and we were conferencing through Skype and stuff like that back and forth, and she, you know, came up with this incredible cast that are mostly new people. So, you know, somebody said they recognize some people from Lear last year, but I think it's and Steve and Raphael and you, I think. So that, you know, for people that have been coming to Shakespeare in the Grove for, you know, 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 or 10 years, there's actually a lot of new faces. And, you know, it was our core company. Many are sort of sitting it out this year a little because we chose to do Midsummer and it really calls for a young athletic company. Not that we don't have an athletic company, but or a young company, but I gotta stop talking soon, okay?
All right, so I wanna thank all the members of the cast and I hope you'll all join me in thanking this cast for providing us with this magical performance tonight. Thank you, Art Farm.